Our next speaker is one of the most well-known speakers, and wherever in any conferences he is there, and I never fail to attend his lecture because I always get many messages, many take-home points from his talks. Is the slides available? Our next speaker is Dr. Shashank Shah. He is a laparoscopic and bariatric surgeon. I would say he is one of the most, I would say, a pioneer in this field. He has his Center for Comprehensive Treatment of Obesity and Metabolic Disease, and also Training Center for Laparoscopic and Bariatric Surgery. Sir has been having laparoobis affiliations with Boston University School of Medicine for bariatric training programs, CMAS, that is Center of Excellence for Minimal Access Surgery Training, Collaborative Research Center with Symbiosis International. He is also having MUHS programs for fellowships in laparoscopy and bariatrics. Surgical Review Corporation, USA. He has treated a total number of laparoscopic and bariatric procedures till date, that is 2019, were 35,000, which is phenomenal. Total bariatric procedures since 2004 till 2019 is almost 6,000 plus patients. Highlights would be a total number of general and laparoscopic and bariatric procedures. I think I have repeated. So he has memberships with SAGES, that is Society for American Gastrointestinal and Endoscopic Surgeons, SLS, ELSA. These are all international associations of repute, and sir is part of these associations. Also, ASI, Association of Surgeons of India, and you can see all these programs, and he is Obesity Surgery Society of India. He is a secretary of this institution. I think the list is endless. I think to in the interest of brevity of time, I just finish with the slides in front of you. He is also an editor board member of International Journal of Obesity Surgery. He is a member of an expert panel of International Sleeve Gastrectomy Expert Panel Consensus Statement. He is the chairman for International Bariatric Club at World Congress of Obesity Surgery in 2010. Over to you, sir. Waiting for your presentation call.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the kind introduction. Nilesh, can I share my slides?
I'll stop sharing.
Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Sunil, kindly allow Dr. Shashank sir to share his slide.
Okay. So let me first of all say that today was a wonderful session. I feel like attending all these lectures again, and I would definitely learn more and more from them. And is the slide visible?
Yes, sir. Visible.
Yes. So now the last presentation we heard about how to diagnose and how to grade, how to define, and we got an excellent message from Dr. Nitin Patan Crespo, how to change goals, how to go over your cues and tendencies. And I'm going to talk about staged approach, and I'm going to keep it more focused on what a clinician should think of when he's starting an obesity clinic. Before I start, I must tell you, when food goes in the stomach, there are multiple hormones stimulated, secreted. One of them is ghrelin, which is the hunger hormone. In the duodenum, we have cholecystokinin. And then there is further stimulation of insulin and glucagon in this part. And as food reaches slowly the last part of intestine, then you have GLP-1, PYY, and there are intestinal microflora, microorganisms, intestinal mucosa, and entirely it's an interplay between these interactions, liver, pancreas, brain, and center in the hypothalamus for maybe setting up your set point for obesity. And all these eventually govern how you would become by eating something, and that remains involuntary, and that is why it's a complex disease requiring multidisciplinary treatment. Everyone wants to have a successful obesity clinic. The key to the success are probably prediction of the probability of success in the short term as well as in the long term. A clinician, whenever offers an advice to a patient, he should have his own prediction of long-term success, and only when he or she is confident that the probability of success is more than 70%, his advice is useful to the patient. One has to evaluate feasibility of advice being followed by the person or the patient. And a simple example is a person staying in a hostel doing marketing job in Mumbai, starting at 6 o'clock in the morning and 11 o'clock at night, and he has to eat whenever he has an opportunity, and he eats whatever is easily available and economical. The treatment pattern for such a person will change based on feasibility of what is available and accessible. Key trigger points or main expectations of a person or a patient, and this was very well elaborated by the first speaker as well as Dr. Martinkar. Patient has some expectation, and our treatment has to identify that expectation, and only then the treatment should be offered. And only a single specialty clinic may not be ideal. Maybe only a dietitian, only an exercise therapist, only a physician, even only a bariatric surgeon may not be ideal and adequate, and it has to be a multidisciplinary treatment. Before I go to my presentation, I am going to give some examples of key trigger points and why associations are important. This is a lady who came to us. Maybe she was 310 kg, and then she lost 215 kilograms. We got the World Book and India Book of Award for her. But why, what I feel unfortunate is, I'll give you through an example. I recently operated on a young girl who was 32 year old, BMI of 60, weight of 170. I felt very unfortunate, and I was talking to them. They had a very close family clinician who was treating her. She was sent to at least 10 dietitians, 20 gyms. She underwent intragastric balloon therapy twice. And eventually the decision for surgery was from the patient. But I believe the damage is already done. She's 32, her weight is 170. She has lost her confidence. She started developing comorbidities, and even though someone offers her extensive weight loss, there will be multiple cosmetic treatments required. And I feel unfortunate that in this world, when Indian clinicians are known to be so well-read, so well-informed and intelligent, why such a patient would be seen in a city like Mumbai, a hospital like Hinduja, that she has been given some wishful expectation over time. The trigger for her was actually what she would do with her partner. How will her partner be? How will her married life be? That is why I'm saying you must know and you must explain the consequences of delayed scientific intervention. It could be dietary intervention, it could be lifestyle intervention, but a person, the patient and the clinician should know that if the advice is not followed or if the advice is not successful, what would be the delayed consequence? This is a lady who was obese for almost 15 years. But she decided to come to us and undergo surgery at the end of 15 years. Was it for obesity? It was not at all for obesity. She had severe joint pain, severe osteoarthritis, and she was unable to walk. So she did not come with a trigger to lose weight. She came to get her joint pains relieved. So 4 or 5 kg of weight loss wouldn't be enough with a BMI of 41. Here we consulted an orthopedic surgeon and then discussed. He said at least the weight loss of 40 kilograms will only make her mobile and pain-free, and you can see here after bariatric surgery. But the trigger is not a weight loss, the trigger is severe osteoarthritis. This lady came with insulin dependence, a professional, moving around, having multiple meetings, was unable to follow a diabetic diet, her insulin levels were increasing, and multiple diabetes-related comorbidities started getting setting in. And then, in spite of being treated by a renowned endocrinologist and diabetologist for 7 years, her HbA1c remained beyond 12, and that is when the endocrinologist himself decided that maybe she needs some intervention which will have a control over all this. Of course, she will need to follow with the endocrinologist, and maybe some medication will still continue. This lady doesn't look morbidly obese, but but she had a recurrent hernia which recurred 3 times. The hernia recurred purely because the abdominal obesity was stretching the wall and tearing all the excellent repairs by other surgeons. And she came here not only for weight loss, but she wanted her hernia treated because bowels were getting stuck. She had 2 emergency admissions. So her weight loss goal was her belly should be flat and then the hernia repair should be possible. And you can see here, she underwent a bariatric surgery followed by hernia repair, but the goal was not only weight loss, the goal was treatment of hernia. Needless to say, infertility in females is one indication where unless they lose significant weight, their treatment, whether conception or polycystic ovarian disease, insulin resistance, or even IVF does not succeed. This is known to all. However, some clinicians do not perceive that the reason for male infertility also can be a morbid obesity. The environment does become estrogenic. Fat converts male hormones into female and they started getting gynecomastia, pseudohypogonadism, sometimes true hypogonadism if it is seen at a younger age, and he got treated. He remained like this for many years. He still got a partner, but eventually got treated for infertility. And this boy who was treated at the age of 15 with a weight of 200 kg purely because the pediatric endocrinologist found that his testosterone levels were extremely low. He had pseudohypogonadism, and after all investigation, it was found that it was secondary to morbid obesity. This is one clinical condition I must stress. Ladies with abdominal obesity complaining of urine incontinence. Unfortunately, many times it is thought to be a gynecological or a urological problem, but in absence of any abnormality, and it is secondary to increase in intra-abdominal pressure. A weight loss of 5%, 10% can improve her overall comorbidities, but would not trigger incontinence, and she is socially embarrassed. A physical relation is affected, and the main indication is resolution of urine incontinence. Therapy has to be based on primary evaluation, BMI, body composition, comorbidities, nutrition evaluation, lifestyle evaluation, and everything. However, the goal has to be to treat the trigger point successfully, and only that is a successful treatment. And these are multiple trigger points which I tried to elaborate, and there are many more psychological, social, in young girls. And unless we can take care of those, probably what we heard in yoga, their lifestyle cannot change. There are different interventions, right from endoscopy to surgery to extensive surgery to various surgeries, and they can give result in morbidly obese patients. These are 2 examples of patients who maintain their weight loss and success and remission of diabetes and hypertension. Even at the end of 17 years, this lady remained in remission after diabetes after 15 years. Of course, these are not representative of everyone. Some weight regain can happen over time, but fortunately, in today's time, we have interventions like what Dr. Patankar said, and we have very good pharmacotherapy, and results of surgery can be maintained for a longer time. If someone loses 50 kilograms and gains 10 to 15 kilograms, it's not a failure. But someone gains more than 50% of the excess weight loss, or the comorbidities start setting in again, then it would be called a failure, and the intention is long-term success as long as possible. Metabolic surgery for diabetes. I see many endocrinologists giving a talk on metabolic surgery for diabetes, how it works, mechanism, when it is indicated. But in clinical practice, probably there is an apprehension what would happen. Will there be a relapse? Which type of procedure? But those with central obesity, with uncontrolled type 2 diabetes, who are progressing to maybe neuropathy, sexual dysfunction, increasing creatinine, increasing retinopathy, can be treated by metabolic surgery for diabetes. And this is a representation that ADA recognized this and gave the best scholar research award to one of our clinical trials where surgery was attempted to minimize long-term complications of diabetes. I'm saying to minimize long-term complications of diabetes. I'm not saying it is cure or anything, but it does improve diabetes.
Yes, Sunil.
As we heard, the obesity management always goes in a step ladder pattern. Anyone would start with something in basic and then goals have to be evaluated. I wouldn't say goals, but goals and success has to be evaluated every 6 to 12 months. And if we don't succeed, it is not ethical to continue the same therapy for 2 years, 5 years, 6 years, which we see they change one consultant to other consultant and he start from the same thing which was started by the earlier one. Too many relapses are interpreted as failure by the patient and patient starts losing confidence. I'll just give you an example. I met a patient who had come for a liver transplant from Dubai who had alcoholic liver cirrhosis. And the transplant surgeon said that before you go get a transplant done, you will have to leave alcohol. Immediately the patient said, that's not a problem, doctor. I have left alcohol 20 times earlier in my life. And this is exactly the example what happens if patients regain all the way, they regain further and they continue. This becomes an irreversible damage to their body. The best time for the best advice is always the first consultation. And the clinician should have a complete chart in his or her mind as to this could be the algorithm, this could be the expectation, and this is how the stepladder pattern for our patient would be. And it should be explained to the patient if you really want to retain the patient in your clinic for many years. Otherwise, multiple relapses make them change consultant after unconsultant. And as we heard from all earlier speakers, I must say that understanding physiology is most important before you start any obesity clinic. Understanding the science removes the bias towards patients and we stop blaming the patient for lack of willpower or lack of commitment because we know that body's physiology is stronger. It is just like an untreated patient with severe hypothyroidism. If it feels sleepy and then you send him to the best psychologist for counseling to remain awake, it is less likely to happen unless you change the basic hormonal or basic metabolic abnormality. And by giving him thyroid hormone, the same thing many times happens in the treatment of obesity. Treatment of any disease depends on the stage, grade, severity, long-term morbidity and long-term costs. Maybe a patient of cancer, stage 1, grade, severity will decide his treatment. But if you try to attain the last stage of cancer by a protocol of first stage, it is less likely to be useful. And hence, I would suggest you should have a fixed algorithm of treatment in your mind. An obesity clinic should have the clinic's algorithm, which should be read and known to every team member of the clinic, maybe receptionist, maybe dietitian, maybe psychologist, maybe physical therapist, but all of them know that this is our clinic's protocol, that when this happens, our boss is going to see this. Having uniformity in the algorithm will give the same message from every team member and patient success will eventually increase. I would definitely like to give a strong message which I have seen over maybe last 20 years. Treatment of morbid obesity, evidence-based treatment is definitely metabolic and bariatric surgery as on today, even though there are some pharmaceutical agents available. Attempting diet and lifestyle as the sole intervention for morbid obesity will make patients lose faith in the treatment where you have not looked at the grade, severity, long-term cost and long-term morbidity of the patient. And this should be a message in everyone's mind. Initial therapy, whichever could be, all of us must know that it is a jump start. All initial therapies are very effective. All clinicians are very, very smart in giving initial weight loss. But therapy for maintenance is different and most important. And every clinic should have their own therapy for maintenance, own protocol for maintenance. Success or failure of it has to be explained to the patient during first consultation. Failure of weight loss maintenance does not necessarily mean non-compliance alone. It means that physiology needs to be addressed. This has to be clearly stated to the patient and then the patient does not blame himself or herself and comorbidities like depression may not set in. Or this lack of maintenance may be a hint for a clinician to upgrade therapy to the next level. I must say the clinic atmosphere and infrastructure must give a feel of a comprehensive obesity clinic. Could be chairs without arms, could be wheelchairs available for a patient who has severe osteoarthritis to be carried from the elevator to your clinic, body composition devices, anthropometry at each visit, friendly staff. They should not be looking at any disfigurement or a morbidity of this patient. Everything matters in giving a positive message to a patient who walks in. The requirements of International Center of Excellence are obesity physician, nutritionist, endocrinologist, oral physician, physiotherapist, pulmonologist, radiologist, and of course, maybe orthopedic surgeon, sex therapist, and everyone. Unless all these come together, all the triggers of the patients are not treated. I am not saying have every consultant in your clinic, but there has to be an affiliation for your patient, for your clinic, that for these problems, these opinions will be taken. Most commonly followed algorithm is lifestyle management, reduction in calories, diet modification, followed by medical treatment, and we have balloon intervention in between. I wouldn't say surgery is always the an intervention. Balloon can give a jump start, maybe give reduction in craving, a reasonable weight loss for 1 to 2 years, and then it can be maintained by maintenance therapy for a longer time, and maybe surgery can be deferred, but only those who are not morbidly obese patient. Now for morbidly obese patient, I must say bariatric surgery plus lifestyle management plus dietary intervention and plus medical therapy is the best therapy for long-term management. Before I end this, I must give you this example of another one who came from England, followed by BBC. BBC followed him many years and maybe was looking at demonstrating failure, but eventually they accepted and they showed a success. At the end of 12 years, he had still lost more than 100 kg at the end of 12 years. This should be our dream for our patient. Whichever therapy, whichever combination should we should be able to offer. I must say that every obesity should be associated to an orthopedic surgeon, to a bariatric center, to a dietitian's clinic, to a psychologist's clinic, or maybe you can have 6 time slots with them, but patient must know that this clinic does not only offer diet, this clinic does not only offer medication, this clinic does not offer only yoga, this clinic does not offer only exercise. They must have a comprehensive therapy, and an attempt to have an ideal obesity clinic is to offer a comprehensive therapy. I wish you all the best to start a comprehensive obesity clinic and make your patient lose weight and maintain it over a long time. Thank you so much.